In 1828, the future of the United States of America was shrouded in uncertainty. The nation was just 52 years old, and it was believed that any small challenge could shatter its delicate framework and send it plummeting into chaos. In this ocean of uncertainty stood one constant: the Second National Bank of the U.S., a nationwide, privately owned central banking system supported by the federal government. The National Bank buoyed currency and prevented cheating and overspeculation by smaller, less powerful institutions. At its helm stood Nicholas Biddle. Under his leadership, the U.S. had enjoyed a long period of economic stability, and many had come to trust the bank and its practices. But not everyone had faith in the bank, including a new voting class of populists who, in 1828, elected to the presidency General Andrew Jackson, a man who seemed to speak with the voice of average Americans and fight for their issues. Jackson believed that the bank was too powerful, and so he set out to amend what he called the Hydra-headed monster. But when Jackson came up against the stubborn, protective leadership of Biddle, his ruthless determination to reform the bank would result in its destruction, and a legacy that would leave economic scars throughout the nation for years to come. But never again would so much of the government's money accumulate in the hands of a single corporation. The National Bank was run by a board of wealthy stockholders and held all of the federal government's capital. But Jackson didn't believe that a government-supported institution should be controlled by unelected representatives. During his first term, reports of abuse by the bank abounded. Branches throughout the country favored the National Republican Party when offering loans, while turning away Democrats. Jackson was outraged. By influencing politics, the bank violated its charter and, in his opinion, threatened democracy.
In other words, it's dangerous. It's dangerous to have a private entity with this kind of power in a republic where it can subvert and undo the American free democratic system of government.
But Jackson was a shrewd leader. He could not deny the utility of a central banking system, so he approached Biddle with his concerns and demanded change. Biddle, a college-educated elitist, didn't want to reform the bank, particularly at the request of an uneducated frontiersman who had marauded his way into the White House. Biddle was an arrogant leader who felt that the bank's past success justified any issues with its lending practices. He expressed to Jackson that, as the bank's leader, he would protect it with every resource at his disposal. He believed that, if he persisted, Jackson would eventually understand the bank's benefits and stop his reform efforts. But Jackson was not so easily convinced. He was bent on reform, and so that no one could doubt his motives, he informed Congress at his first annual address. Both the constitutionality and the expediency of the law creating this bank are well questioned by a large portion of our fellow citizens. Feeling threatened, Biddle decided that something must be done. His protective leadership style would not stand for any changes. Senator Henry Clay advised Biddle to ask Congress to recharter the bank before Jackson's second election, a full 4 years before it was necessary. Clay suggested that the course of the president, in the event of a passage of a bill, seems to be a matter of doubt and speculation. My own belief is that, if now called upon, he would not negative the bill, but that if he should be re-elected, the event might, and probably would, be different. The move would benefit Clay, who was running for president, because he believed that he could beat Jackson if the bank was a campaign issue. Biddle's bank advisors wanted to wait until after the election, and Jackson had indicated that he would sign the bill if it came after the election year. But Biddle chose not to delay. He did not trust Jackson to keep his word, and he felt that the bank was so popular that to veto its recharter would be political suicide. Biddle had been willing to make compromises in the recharter, but because he felt that Jackson would be too scared to veto it and make it an open fight during the election, he took the opportunity to humiliate Jackson by refusing to include any changes or amendments. Biddle was delighted when the bill sailed through the Senate. But Jackson did not cooperate. The fact that Biddle had orchestrated the vote so close to the presidential election left Jackson feeling backed into a corner. He was a man who saw conspiracies around every corner, and Biddle's move confirmed his belief that the bank represented a dangerous political force that he could not control. His previous diplomacy gave way to the leadership of a general outflanked on all sides, and the so-called bank war was not a battle he was willing to lose. In a bout of nervous illness, he hissed, "The bank, Mr. Van Buren, is trying to kill me, but I will kill it." Despite his professed belief in the ultimate value of a reformed national bank, and because Biddle had dared him, Jackson vetoed the bill, saying that, "I can perceive none of these modifications of the bank charter which are necessary, in my opinion, to make it compatible with justice, with sound policy, or the constitution of our country." The 1832 presidential election was a showdown between Jackson, the everyman Democrat, and Henry Clay, the great compromiser and national Republican. Jackson and his presses worked to drum up support and encourage national civic participation so that his win could reach the proportions of his victory against Adams. But Biddle would do anything to prevent a second Jackson presidency. He felt that if the people knew Jackson's true intentions, they would cast their votes for Clay instead to save the bank from another potentially fatal year of Jackson's policies. Biddle financially supported newspapers that favored Clay and circulated handouts depicting Jackson as a petty, violent man unfit for the presidency. Ultimately, these campaigns had little impact on the outcome, but Jackson felt that they were a personal attack, a vengeful scheme aimed to reduce his sizable majority. After handily reclaiming the White House, Jackson learned that, during the election, Biddle had sold part of the national debt to banks in England and had even charged the U.S. government for a default by the French. These actions violated the bank's charter, giving Jackson grounds to have his treasury secretary remove the government's money. But his secretary would not comply. Jackson replaced two secretaries before he finally found one willing to withdraw deposits. In a bid to stop the removal of funds, Senator Clay introduced a measure passed by Congress censuring Jackson for overstepping his constitutional authority, making Jackson the only president ever censured by Congress. Undaunted, Jackson continued to dismantle the bank. Referring to it as a monster, he defiantly proclaimed that, "I am ready with the screws to draw every tooth and then the stumps." But Biddle struck back. He began calling in loans and blaming it on Jackson and his removal of government funds. Biddle thought that by breaking every bank in America and causing an economic collapse, he could force Congress to restore the deposits. Biddle's actions backfired. Rather than blame the president, most blamed the bank for intentionally causing the country economic hardship. And the bank's friends in Congress began to wonder if Jackson was right after all, that the bank was too powerful. Support for the bank faded. Deprived of funds and charterless, Biddle's bank collapsed in 1841. Biddle himself would die in poverty and obscurity, his talents as a leader overshadowed by his arrogant unwillingness to compromise. Meanwhile, Jackson deposited government funds into pet banks favorable to the Democrats. Some of the banks were wildcat banks, disorganized, ill-run, and entrenched in risky speculation. They issued more notes than they had in their gold and silver reserves, culminating in the Panic of 1837, which was far more extensive and destructive than the economic crisis Biddle created when he first called in loans.
Ultimately, there's going to be an absolute crash, and then everything comes down, and all at once people would have borrowed money, assuming that the price of corn is going to stay high, or wheat, or cotton, suddenly discover the price of corn, wheat, cotton, going right through the floor. They can't pay their debts, they're going bankrupt, the banks themselves are going broke. You've got economic catastrophe.
The U.S. would continue to stumble from one economic crisis to the next for nearly a century following the bank war, before another national banking system, the Federal Reserve, was established to help stabilize it. Consistent with Jackson's vision, the Federal Reserve operates within the government and is the ultimate legacy of the collision of Biddle's inflexible, protective leadership with Jackson's ruthless determination.